Okay, so I'm now here to play some Final Fantasy. I do apologize, this is the first time I've ever used any of the streaming software that can be, that I'm now using. I'm using Game Show, and it's been a bit of a fiddle, and I'm also not too used to using Windows either. I'm a Mac user. Anyway, the point is that I finally got all this stuff working. It's taken a couple of hours actually. A little annoying, but I think I mainly had issues with sound and also Game Show crashing every once in a while. And I'm sure we'll see if it's going to survive. But anyway, I'm really quite impressed with the program generally. Anyway, so right now, I think I'd like to talk about Final Fantasy VII, which is my absolute favorite game of all time. I was around about 12 or 13 years old when I first discovered this game. I had a friend in school, and he had a PlayStation. I didn't have a PlayStation until about 1999, I think. I was a little behind the curve. I had a Mega Drive, I had an Amiga 500, weird little thing. So I was still used to playing quite, old school 2D games, and even then I had quite a poor selection of these games anyway. I remember getting ripped off by a friend who thought he was doing me a great deal by giving me, I think it was the Beavis and Butthead Mega Drive game. And it got swapped out for, I gave him Sonic 3 and Sonic and Knuckles. To this day, I have no idea what I was thinking. Anyway, so I didn't have a PlayStation the first time that I came in contact with Final Fantasy VII. I used to go to my friend's house after school, and I'd stay there for a couple of hours, and we would sit in front of his, it was in his dining room. In the corner, there was a television with the PlayStation underneath, and it was this wonderful machine. I'd never seen anything like it. It was beautiful, this grey box, and it was so just beautifully designed. And we sat, and he introduced me to this strange. I'd never played anything like it. I was used to side-scrolling platformers. I'd never really played RPGs. And we got into the game. And you get into these wonderful characters. And what we did, actually, I would speak the male characters of the game. So I would give Cloud a voice, Barrett a voice. I think I ended up doing a very stereotypical kind of black guy voice for Barrett, which is embarrassing. It's really bad, and I won't repeat it. For Cloud, I tried to. I think I used my own voice because we all like to think that we can be the hero. But of course, I don't have that kind of skill. And he would play the females, so he'd play Tifa, Aerith, Eris, however you want to, I think I'm gonna go with I might rename her Aerith in the game because I understand that that's the correct translation or correct name. Anyway, for a while I would play that game with him, and I think eventually we. I can't remember exactly. I think we did eventually complete it together. And all I remember is just the emotional elements of that game. I was kind of torn to pieces by it really as a kid. It affected me a great deal. So much so that I think Final Fantasy VII followed me through secondary school. Now I'm 31. So yeah, I was secondary school ended in 2001. And for a lot of my childhood at that time, I talked non-stop to my friends about it. I think eventually I think people thought I was really strange, I think, in the end, because all I was doing was just talking about this story, and I think I became obsessed with it. And obsessed particularly with Cloud Strife's character. And I think the attachment there for me is very much because I think it's quite clear now, looking back, that I was looking for my own kind of hero, someone to kind of, I suppose, in a way look up to and idolize, but obviously Cloud Strife is quite a confused, challenged young man, who obviously has this complicated backstory, which obviously unravels as the game continues and goes on. And I think really, the fact that he had to deal with so much adversity and that he struggled, and there's pivotal scenes in the game of his childhood, and all that kind of that sort of self-esteem issues and low self-esteem and insecurity. It's very apparent in Cloud throughout the game, or at least as his history is explained. And I think, I was ready to really kind of attach to that. I think I saw something reflected in the character of Cloud, and I'm not the only one. I mustn't be the only one. I know there must be thousands of other gamers who fell in love with the game, fell in love with the characters, and those people who fell in love particularly with Cloud Strife as a flawed hero, I think, who in the end, I think we could level, he I'm trying to put this right, I think he was quite real in a way. He wasn't kind of, although he did become extremely powerful, and in fact is probably one of the most powerful beings on the planet of Final Fantasy VII. He came from sort of smaller beginnings, really, and he had these aspirations, and so he had all these dreams. But really, the crux of the issue is that he failed really to reach those goals, to fulfill his dreams, really. And but ultimately, in a roundabout way, the events of Final Fantasy VII and his interactions with all those wonderful characters and the world, he found himself eventually. And I think really that's what, Final Fantasy VII is very much the story of I think it's Cloud Strife's story, yet obviously there are these other characters with whom he shares it. So obviously let's not forget Aerith, Tifa, or Tifa. I haven't actually said their names out loud in a while. Barret, and of course the other, sort of a ensemble set of characters, including Cid, Nanaki, Red 13, Yuffie, Vincent. I feel I've missed someone out. Have I missed someone out? Oh God. Anyway, I'm now going to start up the game. The idea here was to test my ability to do some sort of stream. Again, I've never done this before, but I've been thinking about it because I think I'd been watching. Well, I think I know. I've been watching a few other streamers recently, most notably LoRunner. I think his name is Arshin Gaia, I think, the LoRunner, and Lobos. Lobos. Lobos Junior? Yeah, I think that's. I hadn't watched Lobos for a little while, but watching his streams, particularly his Dark Souls stuff, incredible. And LoRunner, I'll actually say he's the guy who's kind of gotten me into the idea of doing an occasional stream. Not, I'm not going to take this too seriously at this time. I think really it's just about getting something out there, getting, because my points of view are not going to be as structured, I think, as either of those two guys. And I think really it's just I'm going to be reacting to the things that I'm seeing. I'm not entirely, I guess my knowledge base is quite limited, and I'll come back around to that in a bit, specifically about Final Fantasy VII. But yeah, I think I wanted to see, could I do what those guys do in a way? And I think really what they do most of all is show this incredible enthusiasm. And as I say, LoRunner, Arshin Gaia, his work with Final Fantasy VI in particular, made me want to explore Final Fantasy VII. Perhaps not to the same extent that he explores, because his ruminations are ridiculous. They're fantastic. A lot of the time I disagree with him. Other times I completely agree. And of course I can understand, however, his point of view that Final Fantasy VI for him is the best game ever made for him. And I think he recognizes, or I think I've heard him say, obviously, there's nostalgia has a lot to do with that. For me, it's Final Fantasy VII. It was the first Final Fantasy I'd played. It was the first modern sort of, 32-bit game that I really got into, I think, as I got into gaming later. And yes, but at the same time, I accept that there are flaws and weaknesses that Final Fantasy VII exhibits, not only because of its age, it's coming up to 20 years old now, but I think also Final Fantasy VII is flawed because of its writing, and some of its themes are a little concerning, I think, and I'll come round to those as we hit them. Because I'm really interested to see how they're going to do the remake, particularly with regard to early events in the Final Fantasy VII story. So, anyway, I think I've been babbling on for a little bit now, so I'm going to get into the game, and I'm just going to hope that this is working and that my stream isn't going to implode. Because again, I've never done this before. I don't have the multiple screens that I think other streamers do. I just have my I'm using a MacBook Pro Retina from 2015, and I think it's quite hot, so I don't know if the computer is going to implode. We'll see. And I'm quite tired, by the way. It's 6:10 in the morning, and what I'll say is I haven't been sleeping very well, so or my sleep pattern is upside down, so I'm sleeping throughout the day. And what I'm doing here is I'm performing an activity which is also there to try and keep me awake, because I need to stay awake today. So I'm gonna see where I go with this. Okay, so I'm gonna go in. Now I have this Xbox pad. And annoyingly, the D-pad doesn't work for this, so I'm not going to be quite as effective. On the PlayStation pad, D-pad was it's what was required for this game, really, in terms of the speed of using the menu system. But using this to flick around is going to be a little tough. We'll see how that goes. Oh, I'm not continuing. I'm starting a new game, aren't I? So let's start. Obviously, I can't skip cutscenes. In well, not the CGI cutscenes. And I'm not sure that's a great idea to do so anyway, but I'm gonna start right now, and this beautiful introduction to this beautiful game. Or, well, there you go. Okay, so I guess this is, I often forget what they call this. Is it the bombing run, the bombing mission? One of those. Or neither, maybe. That was an exceptional introduction to the game. That music, just the way that it just builds up and then, and I can't explain it. I just absolutely love the way that. It must have been mind-blowing for a lot of gamers back then, especially the transition between Final Fantasy VI and VII, because I can't wrap my head around, even though Final Fantasy VI was developed in, I think it was developed, what I've heard, they started development as soon as they finished V, and it took them only around about, no more than obviously 2 years, as it was released in '94. And this comes out 3 years later. 3 years, somehow, you see the small incremental improvements in graphical fidelity between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And 6 really pushing the limits of what the SNES is capable of, I understand. From what I can see, it's certainly in terms of its design and art, it's really quite special. But I'll get on to why I think 7, even though it's on a more powerful machine, is even more special. And there are some things that I don't quite understand about why 6 looks the way it does, and how 7 could possibly look the way it does, and I'll come back around to that anyway. But let's get this going. Okay. Ooh. I've never actually run behind that corner before. Okay. So, just this transition. It's obviously quite an aged way of doing things, probably now, but, now, you know what? Already, I failed, and I'm gonna stop after this, and I'm gonna tell you, obviously I failed because the idea of this run is to not use your materia, and I've used my materia. Now that's just a natural thing. I haven't played this game for a little while, and that's a natural thing to actually end up doing. Now I have to, oddly enough, I have to return to Windows. You can't just come back to the menu. It's a bit odd. Whatever. Okay, so I've had to quit, which is, that's really annoying, and we're gonna have to watch the video again. But hey, look, again, first time streaming. Really don't know what I'm doing, but I need to remember this is an enemy skill plus manipulate materia only run. So, and that, there's nothing original about that. It's just I felt I didn't just want to play a straight run of Final Fantasy. I wanted to try and see if I could, play something a little more interesting. And I've never done a challenge run before of Final Fantasy. And this is a particularly interesting one because you still get the opportunity to use magic. Again. But it's very much limited, obviously, to the enemy skill materia, and it changes your style of play, I imagine. As what you're going to be doing is you're going to be hunting down monsters specifically for their enemy skills, for their magic technique. Obviously, I think that's a fantastic, that particular materia is such a fantastic idea. The idea that you're learning from monsters in the field. Now, I know certainly that Final Fantasy IX has a character who has that particular class of ability, of learning, and I think it's blue magic, where they learn, it's Quina, I think it's Quina. They learn magic from the monsters that they encounter. I don't know of, I can't think, obviously, eight doesn't have the drawing system, so you aren't learning magic per se from the monsters, you're just drawing magic from them. Six, funnily enough, I can't recall any characters having that ability particularly, except for Gao, who you could go to the veldt, which was an area where you could fight monsters, not for experience, but simply so that Gao could learn from them, and then he would have a list of all their, well, of all the enemy names, and then the enemy names, once he selected them, that he would perform a particular technique which was related to them. To be quite frank, though, I did not do much with Gao. He had a very tiny slice of story, in my opinion. I just felt there was no real point dealing with him or bothering. And that's it. I can't remember any of the elements which are similar to that, to the enemy skill idea. But as I say, rather than just running around and just being able to blast everything to pieces with the huge range of materia in this game, I think it's great to have that limitation and to really specialize in it. And I'm going to see where I can go with it. So this time, try and remember that you can't touch your materia yet, can you? So there's a blank space between magic and equip where materia would be. So, you know, obviously I can go in here, I've got ice and bolt, but I just need to remember to not use them. Attack only at this point. Attack an item. Okay. Okay. So, obviously, for now, the fighting is going to be a little, I just got to remember, I'm using an Xbox pad, it's a little weird, but I just got to remember to not flick down to magic. It's so easy to do it, because it's instinctive to go in there and use it. But, no. I've got to say, the PC version, I remember, yes, getting the PC version of this game way back in 2000, I think. 99 or 2000, and it was so weird looking at it. It just seemed, I don't know what it was, PC screens, perhaps. They, at that time, they seemed to just show all the ugliness, really, of what was going on in terms of the resolution, and I wasn't used to it. You play on a TV screen, and of course there's this this filtering going on. Whether it's introduced by the TV or the video cable from the PlayStation, it smoothed things out. And you can see here that if you look at the game, these backgrounds have not been smoothed out. Yet some people are quite happy with that, because I think there's a lot of people who are complaining about the fact that Final Fantasy IX has been, all the backgrounds have been smoothed out, I think, for the PC release. And also Final Fantasy VI has been remastered, and a lot of people are quite unhappy with the graphical style, that's the direction that's gone in. I don't find it that bad, actually. I guess I don't have a great deal of love or affection for the original sprites in Final Fantasy VI, but you know, I can completely understand why anyone would, because if anyone touches this game and you know, does it a disservice, then I would kind of be upset. Okay. I mean, the design of these backgrounds, incredible. This is the thing I kind of wanted to raise. Lore Runner has, I think, what is a... I have not done the maths, but he's got 17 parts of a Final Fantasy VI playthrough and review. And he is reviewing every damn element of that game, every small, you know, even just the tiles on the screen that are making up the backgrounds. It's incredible. And, you know, I sat there for a few hours in the last couple of days just listening to him as I play. I'm playing Pokemon Y at the moment on my Nintendo 2DS, and it's incredible just him talking about certain techniques that have been used, and the detail that's gone in, and the pixel art. And of course the pixel art is fantastic in that game. But now looking at 7, I mean, we're looking at a whole bunch of technologies. Ooh, I'm fighting. I didn't even know you could fight here! Again, little details, because I'm just kind of walking around being an idiot and babbling on. Let's speed up a little bit. Again, remember not to attack. I'm tired and I need to remember not to use the magic. Sorry. And I'll come back around to my impressions of the fighting engine, the battle engine. Okay, so yeah, it's good. And if you're just looking at things like okay, texture work for a start has gone somewhere else here. It's incredible. I mean, they have, you know, you've got the walls, the bricks, the ground, the cobbled stones, the lighting in particular. I'm going to stop moving, actually, because I'm going to end up having a fight. If you're just looking at the... And I don't really know how solid the lighting is in this game, in terms of the... obviously, these are pre-rendered backgrounds, but and I would love to have seen... you know, I don't... They must... I'm hoping they still exist in the computer somewhere, the actual source files, the source renders for these, you know, before they're actually rendered, sorry. So that, yeah, the actual 3D models themselves of these backgrounds, do they still exist? I mean, I would argue that maybe they don't, because they haven't gone back and re-rendered these to a higher resolution, and that is kind of a shame, because these would be, I'm sure they'd be even more lovely if they had. But I'm not sure about the fidelity of the lighting, but the fact is, the impression is that there is depth. There, you've got darkness, you've got light, you've got the subtlety of colour, and even back then, you know, they're not... There's nothing particularly garish about what they've done. It's just really, really neat. It's subtle. There's a subtlety, and you know, the little animations, the little I guess the fan up in the top left corner there. It's beautiful. It really is, and the attention to detail, the fact that they had to go in there and create all of the planes of, you know, the ground, the walls, the, you know. The difference there between this game and 6 is that they've had to create, I think, you know, surfaces in three dimensions and have that react to light, and also they've had to create textures which aren't as repetitive. They've certainly taken it up a notch, not just a notch. I think it's quite exponential. You know, the actual it's quite a, it's an order of magnitude, really, the difference in the, I think the, not, I wouldn't say effort, because I don't think that's fair, but I would say the, just the fidelity, I think, of what we're looking at. Final Fantasy VI was lovely, pretty, but my biggest complaint about that game is that all of the towns look the same. I think I'm gonna get in trouble maybe for saying that, but well, it's true. I think it's true. You know, you're moving around, and there are all these, you know, lovely little buildings, and you know, you've got the grass and these kind of wooden buildings all the time, and the only places that really look different are, I think, Narsh, and later on you get to Vector, which is, you know, the capital of the Empire, I think, and. Again, I don't remember much about 6. I played it only, I completed it only a couple of weeks ago, but I've only played through it once. But yeah, it's the fact that it all looks very samey. And so for me, my memory of places, you know, there's no graphical difference, I think, between places like, I think it's Albrook and Zen, and I think Miranda, I think. And then, you know, there's no difference between South Figaro and... I can't remember a couple of these names, but you know, you've got Colingan and Mobley's. I get confused between those two, I think, particularly. So anyway, 7, not only have they got the fidelity in screen, scene to scene to scene, the illusion of non-linearity, although it's a completely linear game, let's not forget that, but it encapsulates that illusion beautifully. And it's something that obviously later games struggled because to display, simply because of the demands of players, where they want things to be obviously 3D for a start. Everything is now 3D. And I think, yeah, Final Fantasy VII was kind of lucky. It was made at a time where the expectations from players weren't probably as high. And, you know, it's okay to have a top-down or somewhat isometric, at times, viewpoint. And for developers, that just means they only have to paint or draw what you're looking at. But now they have to, and this is the problem with Final Fantasy's remake, is they're going to have to paint every crevice of this world and then find a way to make it seem open and non-linear, yet, you know, really, they're going to have to kind of boundary the player, and that's going to be an interesting point. But anyway, my main point overall is that Final Fantasy VII, its design, huge leap from 6, in terms of fidelity, and you know, architecturally as well. Obviously, they're not just creating sort of 2D. You know, they're having to create these in digital space. They're creating actual architecture. However, you know, improbable that architecture might be actually, and that from map to map, from scene to scene, it looks to me like there's very little or minimal repeated architecture, textures. That's what's so wonderful. Everything seems different, and that's just incredible. That's what gives the world a reality and a replayability, I think. It's, oh, I want to go back there again because it's so different from this place, you know. For instance, Wutai couldn't be any more different from Midgar. Anyway, I need to move on. I need to keep moving. Let's move. I keep forgetting the names. I'm the guest now. I swear this is Wedge. And Biggs is at the door with Jesse. Okay, this is Wedge. Okay, Wedge isn't speaking. He doesn't speak. Okay. I'll go come to the... Okay, come on, I'm gonna get on with it now. As I said, when I've perked up a little bit, I've got a bit of Chinese white tea here, which I found in my house. it's my housemate, I think. It's hers, so. Yummy. Right, let's run up to these guys. Biggs! Yes, I was right. Okay. So I'm gonna read, because I'm interested in reading the story. I'll try and flip through at my pace, but I'm not just gonna flip through the windows, I think. I am gonna keep his name as Cloud, because I feel that is, you know, in terms of being authentic and genuine, I feel that it's important that the character names are there for me, certainly, because when I, and I'll get into another element in a bit. You know, I'm going to start writing down all the things that I want to talk about in a bit, because I know that some of the best streamers have things to say, and I have things to say, but this isn't going to help me. This is a brush. Where is a pen? Ah, there's a pen. Thank you. See, the computer is on my table of art. I've got bits and pieces of art. I've got bits of, brushes and paint and coffee table books. Okay, so I'm going to put this here. So there's one thing I definitely want to talk about in a bit. So, and I'm going to call it, I'm going to say it now, it's player character. Again, I'm not looking at any formal sort of, I've not read much formal stuff online. It's just things I've come to think about since watching Lobos and since watching Lorelunner particularly. I've just come up with these ideas. So player character versus, let's say character versus player. That's a point that I want to come back to. And so I'm going to write these down and then have something to say later. Okay, let's go. Doesn't care what your name is. Okay. It's really bad. Bit of an ass. And it's this kind of stuff here. This scene, obviously seeing this, it's just proving the point that there is a 3D structure here. There's something that they built and then rendered. And obviously, you know, they pre-rendered the movie as well for this, but, you know, it's gorgeous. Ooh, I accidentally deleted the T. What am I doing? It's the fact that I'm using the analog stick. Okay. Zoom in. Beautiful. And that was the thing. At the end of Final Fantasy VI, an ending which I'm not that happy with, to be honest. In the ending of that, fortunately, there's no clue as to where or how Square and the developers are going to create this next masterpiece. Because if you watch the ending there, there's a few, I think they're Mode 7 sort of pseudo 3D scenes which the SNES is pulling off. And there's all these ugly transitions, these camera movements, and it just looks like they're having a bit of fun, and maybe they're just learning. It looks like they're just kind of pissing about, and it's a really rough addition to the end of Final Fantasy VI, which for me was not even really an ending as such. It was more of just a kind of, I don't know, I'll talk about that later, but suffice to say, I wasn't impressed when I completed Final Fantasy VI a couple of weeks ago. I was like, what? That's it? What? Okay, moving on. I'm not entirely sure if I'm gonna try and get caught up in too many fights. I may have no choice, we'll see. But, okay. I really am worried that I'm gonna accidentally press that magic. I hope I don't. So I'm not entirely sure what these are, and I wish I had the... Now, I do have... Wait a minute. I've set this up on the Xbox pad, and it's really not as easy to figure out as I would like. Yes, there it is. So I've got to click down on the right analog stick to get that up. And so I'm attacking a mono drive B. What is that? I mean, looking at it closely, it's hard to say. I'm not entirely sure what that is. It almost looks sort of natural, but at the same time, it's mechanical. Weird. Okay. But clearly it's something to do with the security response, the security systems in place here. Okay. Mono drive B. Mono drive. I'm not even sure what... Miss Wedge? Okay. And this is one of the plot points that I certainly am going to be discussing a bit further. I just want to make sure I do that. I'll write that down. Again, none of my points come from a place of intelligence or real knowledge. They just come from questions that I particularly ask. And I'm sure that some people certainly... I know that some people have, of course, raised, and reviewers and journalists have raised about this game particularly. I think when I originally played this game, I used to sort of grind at every possible scene. So I'd say I'd get a level up there, next screen, a level up there. I'm going to avoid that sort of technique this time around, because I think part of the challenge run as well is to kind of involve myself in the challenge of fighting bosses this time, because I think I made it too easy for myself. Final Fantasy VII is too easy. It is an easy game, and that's one of its flaws. I'm not sure what the correct description is, but I like to fulfill a lot of what a game offers. I'm not saying that I'm going to go out of my way to do everything I can in this game. You know, I think it's an any percent, really. I'm not aiming for 100% completion. I'm not entirely sure what that looks like with Final Fantasy, actually. The last time I played Final Fantasy VII seriously was a couple of years ago, and I defeated all the weapons, I got a Gold Chocobo, found all the extra bits and pieces that you can find, but I think, you know, at this stage, I think I'm just really focusing on the story, and the developmental aspects from a layman's perspective, because that's all I am. I think I'm a game player, I'm not a game designer. I love great stories, but I'm not a story writer. I'm a musician, but I didn't write this music, so, you know, I can kind of critique and review, but again, not with any particular qualification. Okay. what's in the box. Say really, really have to pay attention to staying awake. Not staying awake per se, I can stay awake, but just not making any mistakes here with the run. So Cloud, you know, at this point a jerk, but you know, why? I'm not going to be looking too much into what's going to be happening ahead or what even happened before. And now, one thing I'm definitely going to say right now is I am not interested in the canon outside of Final Fantasy VII. Whether it's canon or not, I have really little interest in it. And I think also because they've made that canon hard to access. If I want to go play Crisis Core, how can I go play Crisis Core? You know, and then, I mean, I guess I have to... I'm guessing it must be on PSN, and then you can get it on one of the PSPs. But you know, it's not as accessible as Final Fantasy VII. Final Fantasy VII is on PSN, it's on PC, it's on PlayStation 4. It's, you know, it's readily accessible. And it's also available on PlayStation 2 and PlayStation 1, obviously, you know, in its original form. So it's been variously ported. It's even on the iPad, and yes, I forget it's on iOS, so... You know, it's easily available. But to me, Crisis Core isn't. So, and then there's Before Crisis, and God, there's, you know, a range of things. There's the Dirge of Cerberus, I think. You know, the Vincent Valentine game. These games are not as immediately accessible to me. And plus, I really do think, my opinion is that they've muddied entirely the narrative story, the history, and I really do think that Final Fantasy VII just being as it was just the first of its kind of its story, it was focused, and it has its weaknesses, but at least it's contained. It you know, it is all it is, and whereas, I mean, that's not really a good explanation of my point, but once you start introducing other complexities, for me, it only starts to introduce more things that you're going to sort of raise your eyebrows at and think, really? That's what they thought was cool? I don't know. I'm not particularly impressed with the backstory with Crisis Core, with the range of characters involved and the complexities of those character connections. It's just, ugh, it makes me a bit... So, winding all the way back to my point here, anyway, is in this moment, I'm just going to be talking, I think, generally, about where we're at. And, you know, right now, Cloud, a jerk. But again, I don't think he hasn't formed any connections with these people. He's only recently been introduced to them. And, you know, he believes himself to be... You know, he's coming from... He's going to be coming from... I guess his feelings really going to be somewhat ambiguous. Not ambiguous, but he's going to be sort of insecure about working for these people because he was only just working for Shinra. He believes himself to have been... part of Soldier, and so, you know, he's gonna look down on them for various reasons with the history, and perhaps he doesn't quite believe that they can do anything, that they can change anything. Idea popped up there. Okay, let's go. I apologize. This is obviously a very slow... But, you know, maybe that was my point in a way, and maybe things will speed up later, but my idea really was to really have a look at things, and to really express my own points of view, I think, through the stream. It's quite an odd idea, really, that... The back attack. It just looks kind of ridiculous, really, but, you know, it is the mode, it is the way that the battle system works. And it's funny because I think the battle system looks particularly less refined as the characters become more and more realistic in their proportions. And I think obviously that's why Final Fantasy has, you know, generally, you know, very in a very literal sense, has ditched the turn-based system, the actual turn-based system, with Final Fantasy XV, and before that with Final Fantasy XII. I think also here, it's nice because I think a lot of games from the 90s, I include things like Metal Gear Solid, actually, with that. They were much more able to recognize that they were games. They were also games. They were, although they were, they had a great, a much better standard in terms of the process of storytelling, the narrative, the plot, the backstory, all that stuff, the character arcs, the character design. I think also they remembered in a very tongue-in-cheek way and in a positive sense, you're playing a game. So don't take it all too seriously, maybe? I don't know. I think that, you know, that's mostly for some, well, quite clear through Metal Gear Solid, where you have the I forgot the name of the character, one of the psychic or telepathic, nope, psychic, and, you know, able to move things, sort of telekinetic powers. I've forgotten their name completely. Anyway, asks you to put the controller on the floor and, you know, vibrates the controller across the floor. Obviously mind-blowing in terms of that fourth wall break, and I'm not sure if it had been done like that before. But, you know, it was poking fun at the fact that, really, this is just a game. Okay, limit break. Love it. Very showy, very flashy. Okay, so I'm gonna save, because that's a good idea. Now, at this early stage, you know, I've never streamed before, so I know that right now I'm streaming, really, not to anyone in particular. And I'm not looking at my chat window, so I know no one's really going to be there at this point, but if anyone did appear, I think I'd just have to apologize. But I'm not expecting anything right now, but maybe someone will view this video, perhaps on YouTube or in the past broadcast section. Who knows? We'll see. Save. So, I'm back actually at the point which I last tried to play Final Fantasy VII on the PC. There we go. Again, directorially, just the camera angles. The camera angles that they certainly couldn't pull off with Final Fantasy VI or any of the previous Final Fantasies. And certainly, this kind of imagery just was not the machines, you know, the SNES, Mega Drive, they just were not capable of this level of detail. And this sort of, you know, what was described on the back of the box, I think, is cinematic. And it really is, you know. Now, this is one of the points I wanted to raise, really. Right now, we're talking about blowing up a reactor. Now, Final Fantasy VII does fail in some areas of getting across the population of the planet that we're on. You run around, and you meet maybe a few dozen people at any one time, in any one space. But you never get the impression that there are thousands of people. Hundreds of thousands of people. That doesn't happen, I think, until... well, you know, I haven't really seen the extended universe, but I have seen Advent Children, and Advent Children, you know, does show scenes. I think it's at Edge, which is outside of Midgar, of what appear to be at least hundreds of people, if not thousands of people. It's an impression that, yes, the planet really is populated, and it's not just populated by a handful. And I think when I was a kid, when I was 12 or 13 and seeing this, I didn't really get the impression that I'd killed a whole bunch of people by doing it, or you know, that I was partially responsible for the deaths of, you know, hundreds if not thousands of people. Now, there is a comment made later, and I'll come back around to that later, but by one of the NPCs in the game, you know, about people dying in their sleep. But I guess even then, it still didn't strike me how many people, you know. I think they mentioned maybe hundreds, but also then my point is, was that the intention? And again, I'll come back around to it. So there, an interjection there. Now I kind of wanted to make the point there, what's going on there, you know, with Cloud hearing a voice, you know, who is it? Who said that? I think that was when I was young. I played Final Fantasy VII a couple of times and still didn't fully grasp all the events. And so I'll come back around to that after this boss fight, actually. So again, not using magic. It's going to be interesting. I don't think it's a big problem, obviously. It's not a problem at all. I mean, obviously, this is a machine. It's going to be weak to bolt, to lightning damage, but, you know, so the fight will take a little bit longer. And I think that's what I'm kind of expecting. And Final Fantasy VII probably was the first Final Fantasy, that feels to me anyway, where I didn't notice this in 6 at all, and I didn't notice it in 4. But the fights can just go on for quite a while with not any of the sort of the main story elements, but certainly if you think about the weapons later in the game, Ruby in particular and Emerald, those fights can go on for ages unless you're suitably prepared. See, I'm just fighting ahead now. I'm not being clever about this because if it, you know, raises its tail now, okay, it's not going. That's cool. There, it did. I was very lucky that I thought to slow down a little bit. So of course, better be careful. Attack while its tail's up. It's going to counterattack with its laser. So, you know, I read that, obviously, as was written when I originally played this game. So, yeah, it's silly. It's completely opposite. Very annoying. But, you know, it's something we've been complaining about for years. And they still didn't fix it for this translation, or this version of the game, which I find that quite surprising. Okay. I can use limits. I'm allowed to use limits, by the way, before I knacker myself with any other mistakes or ideas. Okay. This is quite an inefficient machine. It really is. So if I think if something has to use a search scope to figure you out, I don't know. I mean, perhaps that's how things would be. I'm just trying to think, where are we now in terms of scene recognition, facial recognition with devices? I think we're actually pretty far along. I think my iPhone would work a lot quicker than this machine, to be quite frank. One of my favorite abilities in Final Fantasy games is the ability to steal, and it's just an extra thing that I like doing. And I know in 7, actually, none of the bosses have items, if I remember correctly. They do in 9, and it became a big part of that game in particular, because obviously Zidane is a thief. So it made sense for him to have that particular technique, that particular ability. But it's just something that I think of what helps to complicate, or not complicate, but to kind of enrichen the battle sequences in the game. And I think I do like it when you get that steel material. Okay, so a timer which isn't particularly difficult to overcome. I am not going to save it. Let's just move on. I'm sure I'm going to feel very sorry about that. Because I'm not going out of my way to level up. I think I want that to... I'm not going to put a cap on my leveling up, but I think I'm not going to go out of my way to make the game much easier. Because I think it's already easy, and I want to kind of see what it's like to not have to try so hard. Okay, good. Good guy, Cloud. The letters. One thing I still... Well, I've mentioned it just briefly in passing, but I think that the fact is that... The fact... It's not a fact. Anything I say isn't factual, by the way. I need to really put that out there. I have opinions. They're all opinions. But nothing I have to say is strictly anything more than that. But I do have to say, for me, the music in Final Fantasy VII is just... It's beyond words, really is. It is... I really can't explain it. It's pristine. It's... The instruments, sure, but the MIDI instruments... Now, I can't stop at all catching with this timer going off, but... The instruments are... obviously quite limited in terms that they are MIDI, and they're also MIDI on an older system, and, you know, MIDI itself is still not that great, I think, at emulation, kind of. I mean, I now use Logic Pro to make my music, Logic Pro 9 to make music. Yes, I have used sampled sort of instruments alongside my synths. And of course they never really do sound as good as the real thing, but I haven't spent a great deal of money on sampling, on sequencing sort of software, so, you know, maybe I'm missing something, but certainly, yeah, Final Fantasy, the music is limited by the fact that it's MIDI. But beyond that, the compositions, the use of instrumentation, the orchestral nature of it all is just absolutely, it's just frightening how this individual could write so much music as well in, I think, was really a relatively short space of time. So he is particularly, there's a word, I'll find the word soon, it'll come to me. He's certainly, the word is assumed to be productive, highly productive. Look at that explosion, plus. And of course, you know, I think you can get away with the cartoony characters here, that somehow that you know, they just got away there with that explosion, but really they would have been wiped out too. So I think in the remake they're going to have to kind of really give you some distance, I think, or really try and explain better how you survive. Okay. So that introduction absolutely just throws you right into it. Just throws you into it with this ragtag bunch of characters. Quite wonderfully designed. There's, I think, with Tetsuo Nomura's designs, there is restraint in his designs here in Final Fantasy VII. And I think that really does serve the game a great deal. I think Lawrunner, he was reacting to the remake trailer of Final Fantasy VII from last year, and, you know, he noted that there was over-design in the later Final Fantasies. Completely agree with that. There was certainly over-design, probably starting with 8, but 10 in particular, yes, was just... Ugh. I think 12 actually did look much better. It kind of, again, it kind of simplified things, brought things back round to the reality of the use. And now, I've not played 12, but I've seen some imagery from the game, and things do look a lot more sort of pragmatic, rather than just sort of ridiculous. 10 was certainly quite ridiculous. 7, you know, I'm not sure, it's just the world they inhabit. It's the clothing, the, you know, the design of the clothes, it all just seems to fit. It all seems to just make sense, the fashion sense, or perhaps even the lack thereof. It seems to be that what people are wearing is just practical. Again, that comical design, and also the fact that Final Fantasy VII does have a sense of humor, and I'm hoping that they do not take that out of the remake. They must maintain the sense of humor, and more importantly than anything else, just because of my concerns with ethnic children, they must also remember that Cloud also has a sense of humor. So particularly coming up, this is where Final Fantasy VII for me really strikes the mood of the world we're in. We're in a world which is, I suppose the world is dying. And it's quite visible in that, in the kind of deterioration, things falling to pieces. There's a darkness and a mood, and of course, right now, I think we're on a plate. We're on one of the plates right now. But you know, still, it's not blue skies. It's all very sort of dark and polluted. And there's a sadness that just sort of pervades the upcoming scenes, I think. Gorgeous design. I just want to sometimes look at these scenes and really pay attention. These are wonderful. This scene, absolutely. Now I'm always going to be kind of saying the more sympathetic or empathetic lines. I think I just think that fits more with what's happening. I really like to think that these are the things that actually happened in the story, even though we have a bit of a choice to make here. Although I don't think the choice has any real ramification. So there's just a mystery, really. I mean, you don't know yet that this is that the character has just walked off there. He's going to become a major player in the game. But that's sort of the music. And the scene, the carnage here, I mean, we're looking at the aftermath of a terrorist, you know, sort of plot, really. It's absolutely devastating. And you've got this girl who seems to kind of sort of be oblivious to it, really. And when I was younger, I actually didn't really notice all this carnage here. I wasn't really looking or paying attention to the background scenes, but of course, this is where the game actually started as well, from the view of Aerith in the near the little this sort of a Mako sort of discharge chute around the back there, and as the game that's where the camera pans out from. And now I really am noticing, maybe even for the first time I'll notice, because I'm really kind of being a little more critical in reviewing things. You know, all these other people are just running about, panicking, you know, oh my god, you know. But again, the thing that Final Fantasy VII doesn't get across well, maybe because of technology, is just all of the people. I think in the remake, we're going to be seeing hundreds of people running around. I think it's possible. I think the technology is there to do that now. And I think we're going to be seeing, in some way, you know, a lot more devastation and a lot more of a reaction to that. And of course, in our time as well, in this age of, you know, the realities are that you know, there's a great deal of fear, and there are many terroristic activities and incidents occurring across the world. too often. And I think maybe back in 1997, I don't know, I can't really, I don't remember feeling a great deal of fear about the world back then, but now I have a great deal of fear. And I think Final Fantasy VII, perhaps because of the times and the context of the times that they were in, this may have seemed like something from history, like, ah, when those crazy things used to happen. But those crazy things are happening now, so Final Fantasy VII Remake is going to be created in a world where this stuff is happening and it's real, and it's not just a distant memory or a piece of history, you know, in a book. It happened last week. It was on the news, you know. This kind of scene, just looking down, this sort of again, it says something to me. It says really. I guess there's an isolation, a sense of isolation and desperation in the streets. And you know, you had a few people running around there, and you've got a few other people who are kind of, maybe, I don't know, maybe the people in this world are sort of used to it to an extent. I would argue that that's probably the case, given some of the history in the wider universe in the other games. Well, actually, she doesn't seem very calm. There's anything else around here. Okay. Yeah, this camera angle, it's almost impersonal, but at the same time, it's just showing how small a person can be in amongst everything. And I think that really is sold through the music and this camera angle particularly. You've got these windows blown out in the corner, little details, smashed glass on the ground here, just beautiful. Lots of debris, just kind of scattered all over. Again, details that I really never thought of before. Now this is one of those scenes from that appears to be in the remake, or at least in the remake trailer. Fight him, screw it. I think I... still trying to go along with remembering, it's just attack for now. And now maybe I can talk maybe a little more about the battle sequences. And again, another part of a sort of a traditional aspect of Final Fantasy that had been modified. Although the basic structure is still there, just the way that it's been displayed and put on display, you know, there's something so very static. And certainly for later gamers like myself, going back from 7 or 8 or 9 to 6 or 4, which is what I did actually, is quite... it's just sort of unsettling really in terms of, like, whoa, okay, people used to play games that look like this. Of course my appreciation has grown over time, understanding technology and development of games a little better, that is. But yeah, just how they got round to this, how they got from making 2D characters to drawing, building, and then animating these 3D, fully formed characters, you know, again with the constraints of the PlayStation at the time, they couldn't really, you know, put too much detail into them, and of course, they had that wonderful sort of design limitation anyway, it's built into the design. They didn't have to show any more than just the current area, the current scene. So there's no need for the world to stream any other, you know, upcoming street. It's just, they just have to show this particular map. So that meant they could spend a bit more time on the graphical fidelity of the characters. Which of course, as we find out, that would get better. Or at least more detailed in terms of texture design, from Final Fantasy VIII onward. Although, when I look at this, especially in the higher resolution, the I think it's called garage shading. The garage shading here of the characters kind of, for me, has aged quite well, and probably has aged better than the graphics in the 3D character graphics in Final Fantasy VIII. Possibly not 9. I think 9 actually was really, really smoothly done, and for several different reasons, including movement of the cap as well. It was a very smooth movement when you're moving the character around with the joypad. Again, comical, cute, ridiculous, and Cloud being earlier sort of being a jerk, and at this point sort of being the lovable rogue, the arrogant but lovable rogue, I think, right now. Clear from his body language here, just the way he postures. And as when I was a kid, I think this is something, this is cool to look up to, I think. You know, it's really cool to look up to a character who, you know, was a good-looking guy for a start, and was obviously extremely fit and powerful, and had these, you know, seemingly, well, very character interactions with people. Yet, obviously, as the game goes on, it becomes clear that all is not what it seems at first. Perhaps that's true at first. Cloud doesn't really, I guess, care about anyone but himself at this point. There'll be reasons for that as well, but I think my argument would be that out of everything, although there's something going on for Cloud, his base instincts, not his base personality, that's something else, that's up here, personality, but his base instincts, his base courage, his base kindness, I think they are what's driving things still, and that they will overcome, and they do, they overcome generally all of the elements of his character throughout the entire game, even the more extreme points in the game. I'm guessing this is a scene that you wouldn't get if you didn't pull her leg out of the girder back at the reactor. That's nice. So the battle sequences, just again, that was a whole other, and that's another interesting thing. The fact that they had to work on different, they must have had to work on I guess different technologies. So they're working with modeling software to create pre-rendered backgrounds, you know, and textures, etc., and lighting, you know, engines, and then they're having to create textures and 3D models for real-time battle sequences. And it seems clear to me that they must have used several different tools to come up with the character models for the pre-rendered backgrounds, and the character models that were then used in the... I might be wrong about that, actually. I'm sure I might be, but I think there's obviously a divide. And I'm not sure if it was a choice for them to continue that cutesy character element, which continues from the old Final Fantasies, which would end with 8, really, and never really truly pick up again. Even with 9, I think, you know, it's they've kind of, in my opinion, kind of move further along from Six's cutesy characters. But yeah, I find those battle sequences just, you know, the camera movement, all that camera movement, it's all very flash. And a little more recently, I did finally watch the Final Fantasy SGI, or Final Fantasy VI SGI, or whatever it's called, the video which was by, well, it was actually an interactive demo, I understand, that Square developed to show what was to be expected with the upcoming generation on the N64. And the SGI was, I understand, a very powerful and expensive piece of equipment, which was a power station, really, for them to create the next generation of games. Of course, they were far more powerful than the things that they'd be putting these games on, and that's apparent in the sequence, in the demo, in the Final Fantasy SGI demo. But you can see already, and I think that was, what year was that? Was that 1994? I think? As early as that, shortly after Final Fantasy VI being released, I think. I might be wrong. But that they'd created 3D models and animated 3D models. So whatever they were doing, and however they were doing it, they were learning pretty damn fast to go from 2D pixel art, sprite-based character design, to full-on 3D, you know, animation. The kind of, it's almost as if they were in parallel with how what would be happening in the movie industry. And of course, in 1995, Toy Story had been released. So it seems that, there was a paradigm shift, I guess, in what was possible. And and I think, obviously, they were sort of ahead of their time. By creating these 3D, that 3D demo, they really did show that they were already anticipating where it was all going to be headed, whether or not players expected it. So I'm going to say again, really, that you know, I recognize that I'm babbling on and talking probably a lot of crap as well, but these are my points of view, and this is just the point of view of another Final Fantasy VII veteran. I do consider myself a veteran of the game, because I've been playing it now for nearly 20 years, in fits and starts throughout all those years, and I am absolutely in love with it, and I've never really, really evaluated and critically looked at every element of the game, and I'm sure that I'll speed up as time goes on, but I do apologize if it's not your thing, but I'm indulging that sense of wanting to look at things. But I think, again, that influence does come from other streamers who aren't just playing the game, but they're really trying to pull it apart, and I'm not saying that I'm great at that, but, you know, it's what I want to kind of look at and do right now. One of the things, yeah, and again, I have no facts on this at all, except for what Lawrunner spoke about in his marathon playthrough of Final Fantasy VII, and of VI, and of VIII, and of IX. I think he spoke about this point in each of those games, and with good reason. He spoke about the translation. I understand, you know, playing Final Fantasy VI, now that was something I played way later, and only completed this year, a couple of weeks ago, but I did play it in 1999, or 2000, after I completed VII. In fact, after I completed VIII as well. But going back from VII and VIII, particularly, the translation for VI is, for me, it's what lets me down in terms of the character development, because it just sounds like I'm listening to a bunch of children. And I'm sure that's not the intention, but they sound like children. They just sound like, or it certainly sounds like it's aimed at children. And yes, I get that it was on a SNES, and maybe at that time the seriousness of, and, you know, the, I think the, oh, what's the word, the, well, the ability of, you know, for lack of a better word, right now, of games to reach audiences and to sell their stories in the way that we now expect. You know, I think it's definitely, it is the case that today games can certainly be on par with books and with movies and with any other art form, really, in terms of telling their stories, getting their narrative across. I think, or narrative, it's better. So I think that's what's upsetting about Six, that maybe it was a victim of the time that it was made, certainly of the due care that could be given to a game that was coming in from Japan. It's clear that, you know, maybe the company, Square, didn't give the translators enough time. I don't know. All I know is that the outcome is, it's true that the outcome is not as satisfactory. And Seven, I've heard that it might be too literal in its translation. I'm not sure about that. I don't know. I don't have the original Japanese, and I can't read Japanese for a start, so, but on, you know, from my experience of from when I first played the game, when I was a child, and even then I was quite interested in the way that the character spoke in Final Fantasy VII, there was subtlety, there was ambiguity, there's vagueness, and I'm not sure if that's part of the literal aspect of the translation that some people claim is going on, but I certainly think those elements are what make up some aspects of great writing anyway. The fact that not everything's spelt out, not everyone's speech is clear. You know, there are even sort of, that you know, hesitation with a lot of the way that the characters speak. You've got Barrett, who does have his own voice. He swears a lot, and yes, unfortunately, perhaps, I don't know if it's unfortunate or not, but he is stereotypical in some of his mannerisms. Some people thought that he was sort of like a Mr. T sort of spin-off, but I think there's a greater depth, of course, than that, beyond the surface, certainly. But I think the whatever the translation is, however accurate it might be, both in terms of the literal sense and the, you know, the subtleties, I'm in love with it either way. I think the version that we got is the version that we have, and it's the version that hasn't actually changed. I think they corrected a few grammatical errors between the original PlayStation release and the PC release that we now know today. But overall, I love how all of the story is told. Final Fantasy VII tells its story, and it's very direct with that. It still allows some space for the readers, for someone like me, the player, the reader, whatever you want to call that, to kind of make their own mind up about how a person is feeling in that moment. Now, I'm going to come back around to that because I think that's important, that it's important that Final Fantasy, that I think we speak about, in a way, the process of how the player understands the gaming world, and how much of themselves they can pour into that world. And I'll actually say that Final Fantasy VII doesn't have much scope for that, in my opinion. And for me, that's a good thing. And I'll say why, and I'll carry on in a bit, I'm sure. My reasoning, is that Final Fantasy VII is very much, it's a tale, it's a story, it has a story, it has characters. I'm going to compare it now with the game that I really learned about and played through from watching Lobos a whole bunch, Lobos Jr. Dark Souls. Now, Dark Souls is, by its nature and design, a heavily interpretive piece of work. There are characters, but you're not really following arcs so much with them. They're just kind of NPCs that have a history, that have a presence, but really, it's all about the player investing their themselves, I think, in the character, the player avatar. So you start Dark Souls with a character, and you continue to play Dark Souls with a character that has no character. They're a blank slate, and I think that's a beautiful thing. I think it works perfectly for Dark Souls. And you pick up the lore and the knowledge of the world, the history, however accurate or inaccurate that actually might be, even in itself, which is great as well. You can interpret from all of that. You can paint your own picture. You can draw your own conclusions, highly interpretive, and so many people have got so many different opinions and points of view on Dark Souls and its successors, its sequels, and Bloodborne, I think, as well. But the Final Fantasy series is a different beast. It's more akin to, say, Lord of the Rings, I suppose, in terms of... all I'm saying is it's more like a book, which a story that has been told. Not just... whereas Dark Souls, I'd liken to... Gosh... like a dictionary or an encyclopedia of things, a content really of the world. Final Fantasy VII is One Piece. It's I'm not going to compare it directly to One Piece before anyone gets offended, but it's a book really, and you're just playing the book. So as the player, you aren't so much pouring yourself into the characters as you are reading about them, observing them, joining them on their journey. But you are not Cloud Strife. I think that's important. I don't think ever, even as a child when I played this game, I didn't think I was becoming Cloud Strife. I didn't think I was Cloud Strife and that I could, that I felt that I was the one changing events. I just felt like I was reading a beautiful book, a beautiful tale, in which I could move those characters around and have and be part of making that impact on the world, on the events of the game. Whereas Dark Souls, as I say, you imbue the player avatar with whatever you want to imbue them with. Or you don't. You just play it in a more literal sense, and you're sort of at a distance, and you have your avatar running around hacking and slashing things. But when I played Dark Souls, I really did pour kind of an idea of what I was doing and why I was doing it into the game. Final Fantasy VII doesn't have room for that. The story is there, it's set, you are being told who Cloud Strife is, or who he isn't, and who all the other characters as well. But I think, as I say, Final Fantasy, that's what this game is about, and that's also why, it's part of why I'm in love with it, because I cherish it as a piece of literature, actually. And that, again, links back to the translation. It may not be perfect, it may not even be accurate, but it's still in its own right, through the process of being just simply being created, out of possible inaccuracy or error. It's its own beast, it's its own being, and it exists, and it's the only translation that does exist currently. And perhaps when the remake comes out, we will really see if Final Fantasy VII had more subtleties to offer, with what will hopefully be a modern, up-to-date, and respectable translation. Okay, so moving on. I said I would. Ooh, I want to talk to that guy. There you go. Again, the papers are out there, and everyone knows everything, but I'm just wondering how long it really took these guys to get from the reactor to leaving that little, blowing that hole in the wall and getting it, and then Cloud getting on the train. Don't know about that, that's a weird one, but I never really thought about that before. That's the point, I guess. Whoops! Alright. This, to me, seems like a simplified game element, and again, it's about remembering that I think developers making it quite clear, it is still a game, and I think the idea of the security system just seems a little too simplified and a little kind of just kind of, I don't know, but at the same time, maybe the fact that they could all have ID on them that can get scanned, that's actually not outside the realms of possibility at all. But I just felt that its implementation here just seems a little simple. Come on. One guy. That's an interesting point that Wedge makes there. Being a sidekick. I think that links in some foreshadowing way. Not foreshadowing, but certainly linking to something that we don't know yet about Cloud's history and who Cloud really is. Or was. So, as I was linking back to, if the bomb that's gone off, and it's obviously destroyed the reactor. Now, at this point, we don't know, unless they've managed to read a paper themselves at this point, but I know that when we get back to the hideout, there's a TV, and it talks about what's going on and what's happened. And maybe it's at that point that it becomes clear to Jesse what's happened, so I'll talk about that more then. I think it's very sad. It is obviously sad, but it makes a lot of sense. And it's sort of a realistic. Excuse me. It's a realistic element, really. But over time, things do change, and people change. People obviously pass on their knowledge, and places grow and change and become something else entirely, and then obviously forget where they actually, what they were before, and where, and people forget where they really came from, I suppose. And maybe knowing that Final Fantasy VII is part of its intent is to talk about, I think, the changing world, whether or not it's really involved with, in terms of, because climate change back in 97 wasn't the big, you know, alarming thing it is now. It wasn't such a huge argument, I think, back in 97. But there were things happening on a global scale which were concerning people. I think the ozone layer is one of those, which I've read about recently, and that's starting to patch itself up, apparently. and, you know, species being lost. Cities growing, expanding, and just taking over. And I think apparently, you know, even here in England, that's, well, in the UK, that is a problem. We don't have a lot of space, and we just keep building things. so I'm just expecting my housemate to appear any moment, but I think she's still got another hour before she comes home from work. So, yeah, I think I can totally understand here, as Midgar has just kind of built up and around and across and over these slums. It's dismissive. It's just utterly, you know, whatever. At least, I guess in some ways, I mean, now, we just kind of destroy what's there, or what was there, you know, even beautiful buildings that people fight and protest to have saved and to be kept. And then they just build these modern things over them. And I think, you know, there is a sadness in knowing that we're just kind of wiping away our history by doing that. And, in fact, before I just move on there, I was reminded of that when I visited London in April this year, and just seeing the architecture there, the new buildings that have been put up, and just wondering what it was that they just must have removed put that there, because London is already heavily, it's really dense, extremely dense, it's horrifically dense. I don't like London, sorry. And to go even further and deeper with the history points there, I believe that with much of the work they're doing, they have found ancient artifacts in the ground, and that they're now doing a lot of, you know, archaeology in researching, which is great, and maybe to and that's evidence maybe that in some parts, well, in some parts of the world and with some aspects of change, that we are taking care of our history, that at least we're trying to learn, and for the sake of posterity, we're trying to keep hold of things so that we can say, look, this, and learn all about it, so that we can say, this is what we had created and what we've done, and this is what we found here, and I think that's great. Anyway, I've kind of digressed, but I think I'm trying to make a more expansive point on this, that, you know, on what Jesse's saying here, with regard to, you know, that sad idea that the names, there were villages probably with names, and now they're just numbered sectors. There it is. I now remember why I thought that this was simplified, and I think it's because of the mechanic, which is used later. Now, it makes sense now. You're going through a security scanner, whatever, lights go off, the whole train's being scanned. Now, the problem here is that, if the scanner is on the track, then it doesn't make sense. There's a scene later where you're in the train, and you're moving through the train towards its front end, and for some reason the scanner is following you through the train, even though the train is moving, obviously, away from the scanner. Or maybe that's what that would be logical to think that. And so it's just a game mechanic which I think ignores physics or logic. So that's what I'm saying there, I think. That's what I meant earlier by the simplification of the security system. I love that. Little, cute little characterizations about these characters. You know, they're not, I think sometimes it's just nice that they throw in these kind of, I think it's a clever thing to do with characters that aren't going to last. That, the idea that you just kind of get thrown in there with their quirks, with their idiosyncrasies, and they do that pretty quickly with Jesse, Biggs, and Mudge. And here again, Cloud and Barrett reacts much in the way that is to be expected, considering Cloud's initial sort of presentation as a jerk, and then next as an arrogant rogue, and now thoughtful. And I think, as I say, that's because when things are quieter and there's time to just breathe, and this is the first time to really breathe after the whole explosion, and the event, the thing that they've done, there's room maybe for reflection. And so Cloud, I still think that this is Cloud. This is his base instinct, and perhaps to some extent, yes, his base personality. It's there. It's who he is. And I think I wanted to talk more about that later, because I think it's important, because I've heard different points of view on just what makes up Cloud, and I think there are oversimplified versions of that, and I think it's never as simple as what it seems, or at least in terms of my interpretation, because that's all I'm doing, and that's all they're doing, they're interpreting, because really, you know, it's beyond what we're getting on the screen. There is no real anything, you know, so all we're doing is just interpreting. Again, more thoughtful reflections from Cloud, showing that he is intelligent, is somewhat a bit of a philosopher, I think, actually. I mean, I think just that ability to use metaphor to describe reality is, you know, it's good. And I don't think that's something that, that's not a skill set that I think that you just copy. I think you have to have that innately. There you go. More evidence for my point that I will one day make. Okay. And that, again, I'm not sure what Barrett's trying to say there. Again, maybe they don't understand what's actually happened. I don't know. Or this is me trying to... I think I'm being a bit of an apologist right now for Final Fantasy VII by... Or not that so much, more of a revisionist, I suppose, for as a player, because... Because again, I think that the weakness here is the way that they told the story and the carelessness by which the characters here. Again, back in 97, as a kid, and maybe even as an adult, people would be asking so many questions. Today, if this was happening now, they'd be drawing all sorts of comparisons with real-world events and terrible people committing atrocities. Even if, you know, in this game, they're committing them because of a just... valid cause. You'd still hope that the people within that, like Barrett, Jesse, Biggs, Wedge, Cloud, Tifa, that they were thoughtful about what they were doing. Or maybe Barrett's just kind of, you know, he's still pumped up on that sort of, on the energy of what's happened. And he's got a, you know, he's trying to overcome any sort of anxiety within the team, you know, that might be caused by what they've just done. Is it the same thing? Again, this is something that I never really saw in Final Fantasy VI, but this deep introspective nature of the writing of characters who are thinking beyond just, you know, what are they going to do today, or a point of view, or a piece of gossip, or a statement, but actually asking questions. It just enriches the world that you live in, you know? Yeah, there are ghosts in there. This is interesting as well. I mean, I'm just, after having gone a little deeper into Seven, the game itself and the things that have happened, and having that more in my mind, I just find it interesting. There's a couple of examples, I think, of characters who might be here. For instance, these two. You've got one who might be perceived as quite quiet and well, he's saying he's got to be tougher, so we could extrapolate from that he's weak. But the other guy is obviously loud and strong, and I just find that's a... Maybe, I don't think it's anything more than just what it is, but, you know... But, you know, it's interesting finding possible mirrors of Cloud's relationship with Zack. Now, again, I'm not going to go too deep into that, because I still don't really know the depth of the at least the emotional connection between Zack and Cloud. I know some of the basic ideas about what the history is and how Cloud ended up here. Just the milestone points, really. But yeah, beyond that, I don't really know how they really interacted and what they felt for each other so much. Okay. Ooh, I just hit it back. Okay, fine. This guy, I mean, I'm pretty damn sure he's taking a piss. Surely he is having a little piddle in the corner there. I'm sure he is. It doesn't matter. I'm going to interrupt him anyway. There you go. I think that would be my reaction too. Although don't pee in public, it is, I understand, illegal. Oh, and this is another point that other streamers have made about the events that transpire with regard to this pillar. And again, it fits in with some points I've already sort of written down here, and about what might have been possible in 97 with the cutesy characters, and I guess the relatively early time of telling this kind of story and this kind of depth, in comparison to, say, cinema, which was obviously very mature by the 90s and continues to be, obviously is. But gaming hadn't yet really been matured. If you think about it, gaming was only born really in the mid-70s, I think. And, that is in terms of the mainstream potential access with, arcades, etc. But, I'll come back round to the point, I think, about the characterization, the cutesiness, the cutesy elements, which saved the story, I think, from, at this time with Final Fantasy VII, from too much questioning, I think. But of course, I think it's something that the remake is really going to have to look into. That's nice. Okay, I think, I've missed it, but Barrett kind of pops his head around the corner there, and again. Oh well. So I'm gonna save. Duh! Don't quit. Save! Sorry, I'm just not used to this analog stick use. It's still bothering me. It's slowing up my game. Okay. So again, this is a wonderful sort of examples of the illusion of non-linearity. Of course, you're moving from screen to screen, but there's never a point that I feel, because I think it's more like a, it seems to be more like a jigsaw puzzle, like things are just, screens are stuck together here and there. But I think obviously, I played 10 and completed that game, and I was quite disappointed in what felt like on the rails in terms of the fixed camera movement, on the rails in terms of the actual level design, and the lack of what 7 certainly does at Midgar, of that expanse, that mass of architecture and design. And I think there's a reason for that, really. It's just simply because in 3D it's not as easy to pull that off. So here with these I guess, overall, we could call them sort of tiles, I suppose, of pre-rendered tiles of the game world. They are able to, run around in irregular sort of shapes, and it's just that design, the fact that it's an irregular map. If you look at it, it's not a box, it's not a square, it's not a road, it's just fortunate that with pre-rendered backgrounds and the technology, not having gotten to that point where designers have to just kind of now design every damn little detail, because, they don't have to care about what's behind the building in the lower right hand corner there. They could have just designed the textures at the front end and then just ignored, in reality it's probably just akin to a cardboard box. You go inside it and there's nothing in there, obviously, and you go to the other side, there'll be no textures. There might not even be, you know, textures on the other side. I think there probably were, just for the, in terms of, for the developers themselves, they could probably shift the angles of these, of this imagery, but they didn't have to focus on detailed textures as well, because they know the resolution of the PlayStation screen, and they would have known what would have been visible in the end. You know, you've got signs on the left hand, the lower left hand side there, near where Barrett's standing, and you would imagine that they have some writing on them, but you know, you can't read that writing because the resolution just isn't capable. So we're looking there at the monetary damage. A lot of innocent people got killed too. And I guess my impression here is because everything's so dark, I didn't know what time of day this actual explosion went off anyway. But she's saying that at least people could have gone in their sleep, and that's an important. I don't know if that particular point is that important at this time, but. Certainly just the idea that innocent people were killed. Lots of innocent people were killed. And I think now, really, wow. And so you need a thread in the story, the narrative now, to tie that up. And I think there's only one real tie. And then much later in the game, there's another element, which again has been pulled up by another streamer, quite clearly, and for good reason, that they come back round to it. A character basically asks another character, what were they thinking? Did they understand what they did, really? But it isn't deep enough, interestingly, in the game, because it doesn't make you think as a player, really. I don't think it didn't me anyway. I didn't run around thinking, oh my god, this terrible thing I've done. I'm only now analysing it more and more, because I have this space and time, it's a pretty terrible thing that we've done. Again, idiosyncrasy. There's something really quite cute about it, and people do talk differently in this game. There's a different voice. Whether or not it's quite generic or repeated, but you know, but it's still there's care taken, I think. I think I'm gonna go with that one for now. It's a bit of a silly thing to say, but there's arrogance there. And these level designs here, this sort of this screen here, I'm not entirely sure of what's going on. I know that it would be designed very differently now, but I mean, there's a giant helmet, it appears, or something there in the bottom left hand corner, right hand corner, and then you've got these little targets at the top, and he's apparently shooting away at them. It just seems very it's just all very untidy and dirty and rough and cramped, and of course that's what they're trying to get across. It's a slum. Okay. Now, in this run, I'm allowed to get weapons. I did ask myself, do I want to just limit myself to? But I think in another run, and another time, maybe in the future, I'll look to limit my equipment. But at this point, I quite like the idea, but you know, I've not been fighting a lot, so I don't have a lot of money either. And normally, I would have enough money to buy everything I want. Really, see, I can't even buy the assault gun right now. That's crazy. I need to sell something. Can I sell something? I must have something to sell. No. Why would I? Get rid of a few. One potion for now. Buy the. God, this is so lovely. I've been playing Pokemon Y. Great game, good fun, absolutely zero story. But the shopping and the item, the menu, everything is so slow. It's horrifically slow. It takes ages to make any sort of choice or decision in that game, because you have to go through several screens to make that decision. This is beautiful. You can go, you know, come in here, sell, buy, here, 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 you know, you're done. It's simple. And this is 97 we're talking about. Assault gun. Right, I've got it now, haven't I? Grenades might be an idea, actually, because I'm not going to use materia. So I'm not going to be spending my money on materia anyway. Need to remember that. I really do feel I'm going to make some sort of silly mistake soon. This kid is a jerk. Whatever. Feels like a really seedy, odd world that they're living in, really. But again, it goes along with the tragic nature of the tone of the game. I mean, listen to that music. It's anxious. I'm not entirely sure if this is the track that's called Anxiety. I think it's called Anxiety. I might be wrong. Sort of world and economy, and it's a strange thing to have to be sort of responsible for. Stuck behind the scenery there. Again, I don't think I normally would be if I was able to use the D-pad and not the damn analog stick, which sucks. I am going to be coming up to finishing on this stream shortly. As I said, I don't think I'm aiming to be anything more than just an occasional streamer at this time. I'm very busy. I've got lots of things to do, and you know, I have a full-time job, so that's another thing which makes it very difficult. But you know, I've got other hobbies which suck up my time. I'm also playing Pokemon Y, so I can't invest tremendous time in gaming all of the time. But for something, I'm sure that you were able to. There you go. Yeah. But for things that I really care about, and especially games which my Mac can play, and also film and send out, which is pretty cool. I'm gonna just do one thing. I'm just gonna check something because I'm gonna just pause the game a second. Okay. So I'm just really worried that I've been doing all that and then finding it didn't stream or hasn't uploaded or something, and that would really upset me. I think it would just be, I'd probably just have to give up and never do it again, but I think the reason that I think that is because the window doesn't indicate. Okay, I don't remember him saying that before, and I didn't even click anything. That's great. Normally there's something at the top of the obviously you can't see what I'm pointing at. Why am I doing that? There's something normally in the top left-hand corner of the program we use in Game Show, which I have a trial of right now. It usually is, it's indicated there. So, sorry, I also want to note that my girlfriend is watching me. She's the only, a member of my audience at the moment, and she has confirmed that I am still online because I'm trying to check whether or not I'm still online, and I am, so that's good. I'm just gonna do up to when, just as we leave Sector 7, and then, you know, before we get on the train, if I remember, And then I'll stop there.
Okay.
I, you know what? I think he's totally right. In this case, I have been slow. I recognize that. I don't think anyone has ever taken this amount of time to get from, from the bomb mission to Tifa's seventh heaven, I think it is. Is it? That's the name of a bar? Yeah. Now, Tifa is lovely. I think for a long time as well, this is another thing as a child, I not only kind of projected myself onto well, as I said, when you don't in the game you don't believe you're a cloud, but what I mean is when you leave as a kid, when you leave playing this game, you're trying to live up to being a better person or more interesting person. And yeah, maybe in a very misdirected, misguided fashion, I obsessed about Final Fantasy VII and then tried to live up to the idea of how these characters, I was heavily influenced, and I'm very easily influenced, I think, by characters in movies and books and in games. But I also, I also had this vision of what the most beautiful woman was. And yes, Tifa was one of those sort of ideas in my head of what, brunette, brown eyes. Oh, she's got red eyes, I understand, actually, if I remember now. And, actually, for a very long time, I think I was not with someone who was a brunette. And I'm just gonna, because she's watching now, and I'm just gonna, have a shout out to her right now. I'm gonna call her Kitty right now. I think that fits. And Kitty is a brunette, brown-eyed, beautiful woman who, utterly blows my mind. And I don't know, I'm embarrassing myself really right now, but. And obviously I wasn't seeking her because of Tifa, actually, but it came back round when I asked her, actually, or told her about Final Fantasy and how much it meant to me, and she actually played it, and it reminded me again of, actually, what I'd been seeking as a kid, and it was just funny that really, in some roundabout way, I'd ended up with someone who actually now does remind me of Tifa, which makes me smile, and, of course, it's a very... it's a very superficial thing, because my girlfriend's an ass. To be quite frank, she's nothing like Tifa. Tifa's lovely and kind and caring, and Kitty is just... Yeah, oh well. Let's move on. I'm expecting a text any moment now from her. Okay. Now, this is always, should I give it to Tifa or Marlene? But I think I'll give it to, oh gosh, this is tricky actually, because it's what am I doing? But Tifa, in real life, if she's put you in that position, you bought a flower from the flower girl because you felt bad for her. And Tifa now has, and although you don't have that relationship right now, although there is some connection because of their history, it's not great. And, but now, flower for me, and it's, yeah, sure. But that's where I think this is. So Tifa's gonna get it. There you go, the flower. Marlene seems rather unimpressed. She's shy. Okay. Biggs. No. I think it's important that we get the lines out that I think fit the story here. And that as well. I forget that he actually does that. See, See, again, these little cute little. I care about. I don't know how. But maybe I care more now after all these years. But I care about what Wedge has to say. And his character. I always imagine this kind of. Sort of. Not high, super high pitched, but kind of a higher pitched voice. Actually, in the remake, I think it's kind of a dusky sort of. Husky sort of voice, I think. Deeper. Okay, he just repeats the same thing. Oh. I'm sure that she says something else. I think in the original, the very original PlayStation version I said, she said something about careless. She said careless, don't know what you're getting excited for sort of thing, and I liked that translation, actually. Okay, so... That's a yeah, leave. So already strengthening the realities here and the ties that, you know, Barrett has, you know, she called him Papa, so she has what a daughter and a child. So yeah. It's just starting to build on things. It isn't just a superficial bunch of people, you know. It's a family, really. That's what it kind of feels like. And I think that's what happens here. Cloud, you can see him sitting on the chair there, that table, and he's not part of it right now. This family, this comfortable group, you know, who have known each other for however long, and. We as players, though, we with this music and the atmosphere, the environment, the warmth of even where they are, in a way, it's inviting, and we're getting a sense that there are people to care about, and that they're, well, you know, they're not real people, but in this world, they're real people with real stories, real feelings. What the hell? I won't repeat what my partner's text me. But apparently I am a dick. I am such a dick. Yeah. I don't think Cloud would ask for something hard. I just don't think that would be him, so. Tifa, the thing about her is she always seems to be trying to brighten things up, and I think that's lovely. In the face of all this grim ugliness, and maybe there's a familiarity and a warmth at the bar, but, you know, they're in the slums, and they're involved in these acts, and yet she's still able to somehow, you know, be this character. Someone might say that that's lack of foresight, or, well, not foresight, but lack of subtlety on the writer's part, but you can say that, but this is what we have, and so we have to believe that the characters are who they are, because that's the world they're in, these things are what the characters are saying, so we have to go along with that for now. And I think sometimes I might look at critiquing what characters have to say, but I right now, there's nothing that's been said yet that I'm unhappy with. Although, I think actually, rather than that, it'll be that they're not saying the things that I think are important during this particular scene. You feel that as well, and it's quite short. When you talk to her again, you better go down below. It's kind of like, yeah, you kind of just lost your moment there. You lost your... She's kind of just a bit miffed with you, sort of feeling. That's what I get there. And, you know, it won't last, but it's still a bit, eh. And that, to me, is subtlety. I sometimes do the other option as well, because I know there's more to read, and I don't think it actually has an impact so much on things, I think. I'm pretty sure that he has something else to say. It might be later. It might be the different translations. Just the slight differences where they did update a few things, I think, between the old version and this one. Here we go. So, Jesse, look at the news. What a blast. Okay, so she says here that she must have made a miscalculation somewhere. Now, what does she mean by that? First bomb makes her kind of proud. Again, this kind of stuff is stuff that I don't know, unless they're going to really critique the characters in the game itself later, where, you know, later on in the remake, they're going to have to really reflect on what these characters were saying. So say things like that, I'm proud of the bomb, but also the miscalculation. On looking back on when I originally played it, I used to think maybe she thought that she'd made the bomb too big, and it was too much. But, you know, we'll see. And that's one of the things that I'm a little disappointed with. But it's hidden by the cuteness of everything. And it doesn't really matter right now, but they really will have to look at that. I always love that wedge getting thrown at the camera. It's, again, more comical, sort of showing straight away that Final Fantasy VII, even at these points, knew how to get some of the humor in there. It wasn't taking itself too seriously. I think it was too dark. There are examples where I think movies lose their sense of humor. And they're just too dark. And actually, they can still have serious themes. Games, books, films can still have serious themes, yet still have some comedy in them. And I think that's a little more... For me, there's a human element to that, I think. Whatever that means. So it doesn't help that Barrett also has his insecurities. He, you know, asking Cloud if there was someone from Soldier. Why would that matter, really? I mean, I don't know. Maybe he just needs to know what the team were capable of, maybe. So, you know, asking Cloud if there's someone from Soldier there. If they defeated them, then that means they can, you know, what they're capable of. Cloud's, nope, flat no. So it's giving him this impression, maybe, to Barrett, that they're not all that great, and they got away with it this time, but... Because earlier, again, with Barrett talking about, you know, don't you all be worried about that explosion, because the next one is going to be even bigger than that. And I think he's trying to pump his team up. But right now, his being at odds with Cloud is kind of probably not really helping and bringing people down. Who knows? This is the bit. There you go. There you go, yeah. So, this bit here, the blow-off bit, I don't know, blow-off? Is it blow-off steam? Or am I telling him to blow-off? I don't know. But the thing is that then Wedge responds in a... And when he says, I really don't care, which is... Maybe, I'm looking on it now, I can see actually that does look even more dismissive. And whereas the first one looks angry, the second one looks kind of cold. And yes, he responds cold. I didn't read the telly, did I? Anyway. Senseless violence. Okay, so up. Now, I understand that there is some history about Avalanche being an entirely different group, but I'm gonna kind of ignore that at this point, because this game was made, I'm pretty sure, without that sort of knowledge. I think that was all retroactive and introduced over the next 10 years after Final Fantasy was originally released. So, Avalanche continuing its reign of terror. From that, and that's from this, you know, in this game, all we know is that these guys are in Avalanche, and I think that's the way I'm going to treat it for now. And, yeah, I think, again, I go with the sympathetic or empathetic angle if I can. And this is just the sweetest part of one of the sweetest parts of the story, really. And it quickly builds up through the upcoming scene, the affections. Certainly the affection from Tifa towards Cloud. And Cloud's growing affections, growing because of I think he's limited, and due to what's happening with him, so he can't feel as much as Tifa right now, but he will. That is one of the most beautiful images I've ever seen in a game. I think it's absolutely stunning. And no sky, I don't think, could ever look like that. I mean, I've seen photography of the Milky Way, but it never looks like that to the human eye, ever. I'm sure of that. And it's interesting, this game, I think the reason that there's such nostalgia for it is because the game itself has a foot in nostalgia. It, here, with the memories, it's almost like it's describing what nostalgia is. Whether they be these wonderful, perfect memories, the rose-tinted glasses. And I think there's an innocence to that, and I think that's what Final Fantasy VII does so well here with its history. It paints this beautiful picture, and it's just such a high point in the game, and it comes so soon, I think, as well. Well, it would have if I hadn't been babbling on all morning. I also like how Tifa surely does, and I think she's younger than Cloud by a year, but she is taller than Cloud here, and I remember that experience in school. I'm 5'8½", and I didn't shoot up in school at all. I mean, I'm just under the average height, I think, anyway. You know, it's not a standout issue anymore, but as a kid, 12, 13, 14, everyone was shooting up around me. All the girls were shooting up around me. So I think even as a kid, I looked at this and thought, that's right. That's how it is. I just think it's an interesting detail. And I think, again, it also shows the imbalance here, maybe. Or not an imbalance, but Cloud, this child, he feels he has a lot to prove. Yeah. And I think that's why he's made, he's talking about making these decisions. Or, well, he has made the decision. I think he clearly wants to impress Tifa here. He does. And I think it's an innocent thing. It's what kids do. But I think my... Again, this is just the cutesy element. They look really cute because they actually look younger than they actually are here. I think Cloud is supposed to be 14 here. And Tifa 13 as well. He does not look like a 14-year-old. He looks like an 8-year-old. So, you know, it kind of... There's a greater innocence coming through. I think maybe by using these characters, they can sell the innocence more than they could have if they were using, realistic effects, realistic 3D models. And I think that's interesting that a game can get that narrative across, narrative, through its imagery, through its choice of design. That's something that you don't really think about in movies so much, because in movies, unless it's a computer generated, humans tend to be exactly what they are. They play the age of the characters that they're playing, and we lose something there, I think, because we have a lot more expectation then. And I think if I'd have seen this acted out by a real 14-year-old, or that the model was based on a real 14-year-old, I wouldn't have the same feelings, I think, for these guys, because there's something about, you know, there's just something about their innocence right now, which is just so sweet. It's such a sweet scene. I could be wrong. I might be just talking out of my head, but... Of course, that's Tifa crying there, and Cloud not picking that up, because he's a bit, you know, a bit daft. He's a kid. And I think that's, again, that's translation there. In a bind, what? If I'm ever in trouble. If this was too literal, I think the fact that she's had to use two sentences to describe what she actually meant by that, and for the kid Cloud to finally understand, although actually I think he's going to do it again, what, and you know, get a little bit freaked out by it. It says to me that the translation is actually really is quite beautiful. I think, and I'm reading this and thinking, this is actually kind of how maybe someone might talk, maybe? I don't look at it and go, gosh, no one would ever talk like that. And I can hear them in my head, the way that they sound. It's lovely. And that, you know, just that making that promise, that's... Yeah, it's beautiful. It's the way that it's kind of like just that little spot there was sort of a coming of age sort of thing, and it's a theme that I love in movies and books, and I love that Final Fantasy touches on that. Final Fantasy VII certainly touches on that. I know that 8 does actually as well. 8 has some wonderful scenes regarding childhood. So obviously, whoever the writers are, they have an understanding, I think, of the insecurities, the self-esteem issues of being a child, and being uncertain, and having to, you know, grow up and plan your future. Ugh. You know, You just don't know what it's going to be like when you're a kid, I think. So that innocence is great, and they capture it right there, you know, because that's what Cloud wanted. He wanted to join Soldier, he wanted to get the girl, you know, sort of, you know, show off. That was his aim. And, you know, anyone watching this, if anyone is going to watch this, then they're going to understand just as much as me that it didn't really pan out that way. But ultimately, does, but in one of the most traumatic ways possible. Or convoluted ways, if you're being cynical. No, I love the story. I love everything that, you know, really that happens with regards to Cloud's backstory. Says anything. This is odd because I'm pretty sure that Marlene. Now, it's hard to say. Now, just looking at this, you could argue that it. Because I don't think you know really how old Marlene is, but I think she's. I want to say four. There's a 4 year old behind the bar. Now, there could be. It could be that she's actually just playing behind the bar. When I originally saw this, I think it could be the case that the idea is that she's growing up and she has to grow up fast and she has to be part of the, you know, bringing home the bread. And but I just want to not believe that for a second. I really do. So it depends. I can't remember if they say something about Marlene right now. You don't know how to use materia. You're gonna give me the materia you found. Just teach you how to use it. You wouldn't understand. And, you know, you're not gonna need that materia anyway. Don't worry about it. It's fine. You don't need it. Just put it away. Now, I love materia in this game. I love it, and I've never played a game without it, so it's gonna be really weird, I think, playing Final Fantasy when I think about it, without any paying no mind to the vast amount of materia in this game, apart from two pieces of materia. This always annoyed me. She got a message from the weapon shop man upstairs. Okay. He has something he wants to give you. The weapon shop man upstairs has something he wants to give you. Okay. Now, I think it took me years to figure that out, and I think I just missed what, you know. Okay, I just missed exactly what was said there to Marlene. I'll check that again later, and I'll come back around to it. I'll write here, Marlene, because I think it gives a clue as to what they're doing with Marlene there. Now, I've got to go up here, because I've missed this scene before by running into the store. Again, mirroring here. Johnny. Mirroring Cloud in terms of starting out, you know, just that sort of starting out young and naive. But, you know, wanting to be a better man. Cloud wanted to be soldier. Johnny wants to be a better man. He's gonna go and discover the world, you know, whatever he's just gonna go and do it. Discover himself, so. That's interesting. The woman who clearly got her got the, you know, a finger on the pulse of the Great Plan. That's a weird point. Okay. Oh, sweet. And I believe these are his parents here. The little details in this little spot as well are, you know, very cute. You've got the sort of the what, I guess it's the biker jacket, the leather jacket. In here, you have toilet roll. I always found that really funny when you come in here and this it's toilet roll. What do you expect? But the fact that someone actually modeled the most mundane stuff. There's a pair of slippers on the floor there. And I also like how in the game, this is something that 3D games wouldn't do for years, by the way, neither on PC or on PlayStation, sort of just random crap just laying around. You wouldn't often find that in you wouldn't find it in 3D games because they'd have to render that stuff and it would just be a cost. But with the pre-rendered background, they could render things, put things in. Look at all this, there's a toy car here. You know, there's just rubbish laying around. There's a, yeah, and the little sort of paraphernalia of whatever it all is. It's just such a strange mixture of things, and it's just supposed to take so much time to create all the individual artifacts in the game, all the individual assets in the game. And not just their shape, but their textures and the way that they were lit. Oh, it's incredible. What I'm gonna do. There you go. Just take this down. Sad. Again, just these little details. It seems that each character has quite a little bit more to say than they did in 6, I think, as well. Certainly. There's a bit more colour in all the characters, I think, and it really does help that they've built all these 3D models, and a lot of them are not repeated, or certainly not repeated as often as the ones in 6 are. Now what I'm going to do is, now I've got to be mindful here, this is fine, isn't it? The weapon shop guy, just before, because what I'm going to do is, I'm coming to the end of this stream, at the weapon shop guy upstairs, I always thought was are there stairs to the back of this place? Is he up there? And, you know, there's a big part of me as well that just kind of wished that there was more behind everything. But when you start to really break down what's happening in a level, you just know that at the end of the day, there's nothing in the top of this bar. You can never get in there, and I think that's really sad. There's something there about worlds I really want to get in and explore. You can't go any further, and I think that's why the step of going 3D is kind of cool. But still, in a 3D world even, nothing's quite tangible. You can't really get there, and there's always going to be limits about where you can go, and just to the absolute fidelity of the game, it just doesn't really exist. Anyway, so the shop, I think the weapon shop guys, yes, it's the guy on the second floor here, or first floor if you're that kind of person, of this rise here of rooms. He's the guy who, you know, was talking about how the avalanche, how their terrorism is basically allowing the weapons store to do well. It's them, or him, that I think she's talking about, but I'll tell you, it confused me as a kid for ages. The weapon, the weapon shop guy upstairs, ugh. I don't know. And I really didn't put two and two together for a long time. Anyway, so I'm going to save. And that has taken an incredibly long time. How long? Okay, an hour, isn't it? I've been playing, well, I know I was talking for a long time before, but I've only been playing for an hour and 27 minutes. That's not too bad. That's not as bad as I thought, really, actually. I thought, I swear I was going to look at that, and, but I don't know, I haven't actually looked at the stream time, actually. So, I'm now going to leave this game. There you go. And I'm going to come in here. And I think the sun has risen behind me as well, which is another funny thing. That's going to look kind of weird on the stream. I don't actually have any way of time of seeing what time I started the stream, not from what I'm looking at. Anyway, it doesn't matter. That's the first ever stream I've ever done. I'm not sure if it was a success or not. I'm actually going to go and like sort of review some parts of it now, just to see, you know, what I can learn and maybe do better next time. I've written down some points. I think I'm just going to keep building points to talk about, because I think what's happening here and what's becoming, I think, is it's an analysis, I think, and a critique, not just a playthrough of the game. I think I'm really trying to just kind of put things together, but I'm also trying to put it together not just as someone who's actually played the game before, but also maybe trying to put it together as it comes. So, as I say, I'm not interested in the wider universe, in the wider canon. I'm just not, you know. And when it comes to Final Fantasy, they're remaking Final Fantasy VII, and perhaps the remake will introduce more elements of the expanded canon. But I really, for this stream, that's all I'm going to be focusing on, and that's where my arguments will lay, in the design and the narrative of this game, as it was in 97 when it was a standalone game. Okay, so I'm gonna now... Oh no, actually I've got the time. 2 hours and 37 minutes right at this point, so that's not too bad, is it, for a first stream. As I say, I'm not gonna be doing this... I'm a casual streamer. I'm not gonna be doing anything too crazy. I have a full-time job. I'm very busy. I have much to do with my time, and I'm going to be coming back to this for meaningful sort of playthrough, analysis, critique of Final Fantasy VII, and we'll see where it goes from there. I've really enjoyed it. It's been a great deal of fun. And right now, I'm just going to say goodbye. And if you've watched this, whether I'm sure no one's actually watched this on the stream apart from my partner, as it's the first time, I wasn't expecting anything else. I also forgot to put Final Fantasy VII as the game I was playing on Twitch, actually, in the header, because I understand that if you do that, you actually end up in the broadcast list, and so I think I would have missed out on that. So next time I need to remember to do that. But you know, if you have watched, or you're watching at a later time, then I hope you've enjoyed this. If not, you know, it's fine. I think I'm gonna hopefully leave a way for there to be some feedback from anyone who's possibly gonna view this. Anyway, I will now say goodbye. And funnily enough, I need to learn to look at the camera more, I think, because I keep looking at my face in the little. In my view on game show. So I'll say goodbye, and have a lovely day, whatever you're doing. Until next time, bye.